I am delighted to be here as the first speaker in the Designing for the Unknown speaker series, which is hosted by the Connect Research Center at Trinity College Dublin. And the unknown that I was, the challenge I gave to myself was to think about the unknown of 5G telecommunications technology. So one of the reasons I challenged myself to focus on 5G, which is a little bit more technical and wonky than most of the research subjects I work on, is that I have written a lot over the past 5 or 7 years about smart cities and data-driven urbanism and public archives and kind of knowledge infrastructures. And I realized that a lot of the realization of these visions, if they are ever realized, requires that we have sufficient hardware to make these dreams possible. And one of those necessary kind of essential infrastructures ostensibly is 5G telecommunications technology. So that's really why I wanted to focus on this, to see how the facts on the ground of 5G will or will not make possible all of these other kind of idealized urban systems that I have been writing about for several years. So one of the areas that I discussed was how we take that imaginary, that unknown element of 5G, and turn it into something that's actually manifest in the physical landscape. So the first section of my talk was about facts on the ground. That was the title of the first section, where I talked about how 5G is actually operationalized in the form of hardware that is implemented in small cells and other types of antennae and energy sources and sensors and monitors, etc. All of these little pieces that add up to big pieces that are actually physically visible and present in our physical environments that make 5G possible. So the fact that 5G technology is actually implemented on a more micro scale than a lot of previous generation technologies, which means that it's essentially implemented kind of on a more neighborhood block-by-block scale, whereas, for example, with 4G, we might look up in a vacant lot a few blocks from us and see a massive cell tower. Those will still be there, but with 5G, because we need more repetitive infrastructure to essentially repeat or to encourage the transmission of more fragile signals, essentially, these millimeter waves, we need a lot more tiny infrastructure implemented on a block-by-block basis, essentially. And because of that, it is something that is going to be more physically and tangibly present in people's everyday lives. And for that reason, people have opinions about its existence. Some of their concerns are about the fact that this is, again, not unique to 5G, but because it is a technology that is more in the public discourse and in public consciousness, maybe in a new way, more so than previous generations have been, people are now, I think, a large proportion of communities are concerned about the telecommunication companies' co-optation of public space, of the public domain to implement their infrastructure, about its potential implications for property values, even just the visibility, the beauty of the sidewalk, for instance. How it will change the cityscape, the visual urban landscape. Another section, another issue that I discussed last night was about, again, a discourse that actually kind of exists in a space between humans, organic bodies, and the ether. The fact that things like electromagnetic spectrum is something that's really hard to wrap your head around. All the different types of radiation and energy waves, electromagnetic radiation, it's hard to tell. Some of them have a really negative connotation, causing cancer, for instance, with like radiation. And others are also make possible all of our communication. It's really hard to ferret out which are the good waves versus the bad waves, and even that's a very simplistic way of putting it. But because of this, the concern about the new form of essentially physics of how 5G will work with millimeter waves, and the fact that there hasn't been a whole lot of research yet on how this specific wave interacts with human bodies, there has been some concern in certain communities about the potential health effects. Of course, a lot of scientists, medical professionals dismiss these claims, claiming that millimeter waves are non-ionizing radiation, we have nothing to worry about. But there is still some concern. Part of that might be dispelled if we have greater scientific literacy, understanding of the physics of how this will operate. But another point I made last night was that if you do look at the history of environmental injustice with marginalized populations, whether in the global south or on the margins of even countries or cities in the global north, there has been a long legacy of people having really fraught relationships with infrastructure, like waste disposal and being kind of on the short end of supply chains, for instance. So it kind of makes sense where there's this legacy of disenfranchisement why certain marginalized populations would also be concerned about what could potentially, what more bad could happen to them with 5G. So another issue I addressed, I tried to kind of structure my talk in terms of scale by starting out at the neighborhood, then scaling out from the relationship between the body and the ether, kind of living in the troposphere above the neighborhood, and then I started to look at the scale of the whole world. And I'm really making the point that 5G's discourses and debates happen on all of these scales simultaneously, and that these different scales of discussion really inflect and inform one another. 5G has become, as are many telecommunications issues or technology issues, a geopolitical debate. And this is in large part because we have supply chains of hardware. A lot of the world increasingly depends upon China, and specifically Huawei, to provide a lot of their hardware for 5G telecommunications. Because certain countries, my own, I will say, the United States has vilified China in so many regards, and essentially regards the use of Chinese hardware as a potential cybersecurity threat, the United States government has essentially banned using Chinese hardware in a lot of our own 5G implementations, and prohibited American companies for supplying kind of component parts for the creation of a lot of that material, which, because of the kind of global entanglement of all of these systems, has essentially pushed a big pause button on what can happen in the rest of the world. So a lot of the rest of the global north is really waiting to figure out what happens between the United States and China before they can confidently and expediently roll out their own implementations of 5G. And then I ended the talk after discussing this whole pause button issue, the fact that even though it is a big headache for so many people in the world that there is this geopolitical fight happening right now, and it might actually be for the sake of the public good an auspicious happening, because it gives us maybe some time before we go full scale, full tilt, rolling out the infrastructure to maybe ask some more fundamental questions about what, again, hopes and dreams are infused with this technology, what kind of network politics we want it to embody, what kind of a future we want to build. There are lots of kind of utopian and pro-social things that we're imagining 5G will make possible, as we have with so many technologies that have come before them, from print and radio and the telephone and television and film, etc. They're mostly, for the most part now, visions hatched by engineers and corporations. And so maybe we can take a few cues from places like activists for community broadband networks or mesh networks or other types of community infrastructure groups to think about maybe there are other values we want to infuse in this technology before we roll it out. So last night I used the term imaginary, infrastructural imaginaries, as a way to gesture towards existing research that's been happening in that field. But another synonym for that would be dream, and dream is a word that might be much more familiar to a lay public than imaginary as a noun, which sounds a little bit stilted and academic. So if we turn, I wanted to turn towards the end of the talk, towards thinking about dreaming rather than imaginaries as this academic concept. And the dream that I proposed, and it didn't necessarily assume everyone would agree with me, is we would use this opportunity to build a new infrastructure as simultaneously an opportunity to dream about building a world that is embodying values that are maybe more in line with our idealistic versions of ourselves.